He's a well-respected author on prayer and the spiritual life, and he's here to give us some tips on how we can grow closer to God. So please stay with us. Thank you very much, and welcome. I'm Father Mitch Pacwa, and welcome to EWTN Live, which is our chance to bring you guests from all over the world, and we're bringing them from far away today. But before we get to our guests, I want to mention that today is the feast of St. Vincent of Saragossa in Spain. He died during the persecution of Emperor Diocletian, as we also had yesterday with St. Agnes dying in the same persecution. And this was the last, but the worst, of the Roman persecutions. Diocletian was trying to keep his empire united, and especially his associates, Licinius and others, believed that if they just got everybody to worship the Roman gods and stop Christianity, the empire would be safe. Well, it wasn't. And all that happened is the empire still fell, but gave us one more great martyr and great saint to be an example for the rest of us in the face of persecution for the faith that still goes on in the modern world far more than it went on at the time of Diocletian and the Roman Empire. So pray for those who are suffering persecution to this day, especially in places like Syria, and Egypt, and Pakistan, Indonesia, Africa, Nigeria. It's terrible for these folks. So pray for them that the strength of St. Vincent would be theirs. Now, we do have a guest tonight. He is a native of France, and he's a priest and a spiritual director with a small community known as the Community of the Beatitudes. Was founded in France as an international association of the faithful of pontifical right, specific place in canon law. And he has written extensively on prayer and the interior life. And he's here tonight to help us understand how we can deepen our spiritual relationship with the Lord. So please welcome Father Jacques Philippe. Father Jacques.
Thank you. Bienvenue.
And also want to mention, joining us tonight is, to help us as a translator in our conversation, since Father Philippe's primary language is French, is Christina Borges, a good longtime friend of the network. So welcome, Christina. Appreciate you being here with us. So, Father, we'll try to use English.
Yes,
and when we stumble along, we'll get Christina to set us straight.
Okay.
Now, first of all, how long have you been a member of the Community of the Beatitudes?
Oh, 39 years.
It's 39 years.
The community is 40 years old. It has been founded in 73.
Okay.
And a few years later, I entered the community.
So you've been there from the beginning, practically?
Yes.
Yeah. And, you know, what would be one of the main tasks or goals of the Community of the Beatitudes? What's their mission?
I think the first mission is prayer, searching to live at the presence of the Lord and to serve God and the Church and the Gospel. But the community has been founded by a group of lay people. And in the community, so now we have, in fact, three branches. We are no more an association, we are an Institute of Consecrated Life, for a few years now, and so we have three branches. One branch with priests and consecrated brothers, one branch with consecrated sisters, and one branch with lay people, married or single people, but lay people.
Okay.
And a whole family with different vocation, but one family serving God. And mostly we want to be united to God in prayer, but also for us, we have also many different apostolates. And perhaps the most important charism of the community is to try to live a little like the first Christian community, mm-hmm. and to have a way of life that could show the presence of the kingdom among us. And the kingdom is not only something future, a little abstract, but a beautiful reality. And I think an important aspect of Christian life is to anticipate through our way of life the presence of the future kingdom. Through union with God, prayer, peace and praise, and love, loving each other, and serving the church, and serving the poor, and preaching the gospel, to be an image of the church waiting for the coming of Christ, and trying to anticipate the beauty of the future kingdom of God.
I myself first came across the community of the Beatitudes when I was living in the Holy Land,
yes.
Back in 1994.
Yes.
And I met some members of the community, and I remember that one of their goals was to be a source of peace,
yes.
You know, in a fairly tense region, yes. of the world.
Yes, and also one aspect of our vocation is to pray for the Jewish people, because we know, according to the scripture, that there cannot be a fulfillment of the story of salvation without the presence of the Jewish people,
yeah.
because he has a special vocation. And also we think that for us Christians to know better the Jewish tradition and how they, the Jewish liturgy, the Jewish way of understanding the scriptures is very nourishing for us, and it helps it helps us to have a better understanding of the gospel, of who is Christ, and so on. And so these are the two important aspects for us. Pray for the relationship between the church and the Jewish people, and help the church to be more and more open to the riches of the Jewish tradition, to receive them, and so to increase and deepen our own Christian faith.
Yeah, no, that's extremely important.
Yes,
extremely
I think
important.
So.
Not only for understanding the Old Testament,
yes.
but also the way that Jewish people live out faith,
yes.
beyond the Old Testament, you know, up until the present time.
Yes.
Now, one of the areas that you have been working in quite a bit is the area of the spiritual life.
Yes.
In prayer.
Yes.
And, you know, what I'd like you to do is to open up our conversation. Talk a little bit about what are some of the key elements people need to look for,
yes.
in the spiritual life. What should they be thinking about in their spiritual life?
Yes. One thing I would like to say, I would not say I worked on spiritual life,
okay.
because it's not a topic you have to study,
yes.
something you have to live. So I tried to live a spiritual life according to my vocation and the vocation of the community. And also as a priest, very quickly, I had to preach a lot, to give retreats, and also to receive people for spiritual direction and so on. And so more and more I realized how spiritual life is important, is essential. If mostly in the world today, if we do not have a deep spiritual life, a deep prayer life, and understanding how to live the gospel today, I think we are lost in our world.
Yes.
So, and
very much so.
And for me, what helped me to understand what is spiritual life, what the my own experience in the community. it was also what I could receive from the riches of the church in my studies, and also I met many spiritual authors that were have been very important for me, the Carmelite tradition, John of the Cross, Thérèse of Avila, Little Thérèse, and also Francis of Sales and other great spiritual masters. And for me, it has been very nourishing because when I met these authors, it was a time in France in which the spiritual life very often was very, very poor. And it was a suffering for me. And so when I met these authors, for instance, Little Thérèse of Lisieux, for me it was marvelous because I could find with the testimony, the words of these authors, how to understand what is the true spiritual life. And it was very helpful for me. And as a priest, I could share what I received from these authors. So this is an important source for me, but I think perhaps the most important source for me, for my understanding and also my teaching after, it is meeting with people, because I gave many retreats in many different countries, and very often I had the opportunity to speak with people who wanted to share with me difficulties, problems, sufferings, questions, very different. And so listening people and praying with them, trying to understand what they were living, and also trying to understand how God was working in their life, and seeing how God was working in the life of so many people who were normal people but wanted to have some light and to understanding of the will of God. But for me, it has been very, very helpful. Because I could see what is human nature, human suffering, human difficulties, human question, but I could see in a very realistic way how God is working, how he comforts, he enlightens, he helps somebody who has a good will to go on and to find hope and peace. And so
from what you describe, it sounds as if on one hand,
yes,
you have encountered a depth of the spiritual life in the great writers like Teresa of Avila, John of the Cross, François de Sales,
and
Little Thérèse, that you meet them, but it's not just a world of books.
No,
it's also coming to meet people for whom these realities resonate with truth. They ring true like a good bell, this fits together in real life.
Yes. For instance, I wrote some books, seven books, and they had a very beautiful distribution, and I did not expect this. But I never thought to write nothing. But when I gave retreats, after some years, I spoke often on prayer life, on inner peace, on interior freedom, guidance of the Holy Spirit. And so I gave many retreats, and I could realize what was helpful for the people, what could help them to find a way to increase the personal spiritual life, and how to get out of some difficulties, discouragement, and so on. So I had this experience that some things I was sharing with the people in a retreat were very helpful. So I said to myself, perhaps this retreat I have given 7-10 times, I could write it. So I can reach more people than the 40 people you have during a retreat. So I decided to write the first book, and some years later another one, and so on. And I think they had a good distribution, because it's not book coming from a library and intellectual work, but coming out of experience. And
now, given that, what would be some of the specific things that people would find helpful? What, when, as you give these retreats, what resonates for people? What makes sense to them?
For different things. One thing I think is very important is to help people to pray and to be faithful in personal prayer life. And because when you give prayer to somebody, you give everything. Because giving prayer, helping faithful prayer, you give God. And So, so importance of personal prayer life and how to help people to have a faithful and good prayer personal prayer life.
And well, for instance, give us some examples. Like, what would be a good kind of suggestion to help people with their prayer life? Like, if you were giving a retreat, what would you ask them to do to help their prayer life?
The first thing is to be perseverant. This is the more important. And Jesus not ask us to pray well, but he ask us to pray always and yes. in a faithful way. So I think also we have to accept to have a great faith and to accept. So if we understand the very beautiful things, it's fantastic. If you have a very deep, beautiful feelings, it's fantastic. It helps a lot. But even if we feel poor, we don't understand anything in our life, we have to believe, to go on with faith and perseverance. And this is very important. And also another thing that is very important and in spiritual life is to discover in such a deep way the goodness of God, the mercy of God, how God is a Father that can bring you, lead you to accept yourself completely. That is not always very easy because I met so many people in my life that were telling me, Father, I don't accept myself. I hate myself. Sometimes I heard, I don't bear myself. Je ne me supporte pas, comme on dit.
I cannot stand myself.
I can't stand myself.
I heard many times. But I think it's very important to accept oneself. Because if you accept yourself, you accept the love of God for you. And you are also more able to accept other people. So for me, it's a very important point.
What is it you think stops people from being able to accept themselves? What prevents this or is a block?
I think different things. Because well, everyone has some wounds, some defects. Nobody's perfect. So everybody in some aspect of his life, he's not as he dreams to be. But what is difficult in accepting oneself is that sometimes we feel that we need to be perfect. If I am not perfect, God won't love me. If I am not perfect, the people around me won't accept me, won't love me. So it is a fear, the fear not to be loved. This is one aspect. I think also there is a kind of pride, more or less conscious, but we want to be the most intelligent, the most beautiful, the most successful man or woman. And we have a strong tendency to inflate our ego. To be accepted by other people and also to be proud of oneself because we need to be recognized by other people. These are the difficulties. What we have to understand is that the love that we receive from God not depend on our perfection, but depend on our trust, our faith, our openness to God. And I think when we meet God in a deep way in prayer life, when we understand who is God, how God is merciful, how he loves us, how we are his children, beloved, how the grace of God rests on us, we can accept ourselves. Sometimes for self-acceptance, some psychological help can be useful, but I think the deepest help is faith in the mercy of God and faith in my adoption as a son of God. I have been baptized, adopted by God, created by God with love, and there is a grace upon my life. And even if I am not perfect, even if I am wounded, even if sometimes I made mistakes, there is a grace upon me. A gift of God, a free gift, gracious gift, not something I have to build, So for me, this is the most important in spiritual life, not to build something, even if we have efforts to do, but to receive something, receive the love, receive the grace. Because everything is a gift in the life. Life is a gift, grace is a gift.
Right.
And so we have to do our own work. We have to do something. We have not to be lazy. But the most important in spiritual life is to understand how to receive, how allow the grace of God to descend upon our life. This is the most important.
I was reading recently and praying over Matthew chapter 10,
yes,
where our Lord sends the apostles out, but he lets them know they depend on God's providence.
Completely, yes.
They depend on the Holy Spirit to give them wisdom and words to speak.
But it's not easy for us to accept to depend.
Yes.
Because we need humility. We need a lot of humility to depend, to receive. Because who would be the creator? I would be the creator of my life. Mm-hmm. But I have to accept everything. So this we need humility and confidence. And I think this is our two bases for spiritual life.
Yes.
Humility and confidence, a complete confidence, trust in the love of God and the mercy of God.
Well, in some ways, it's so easy to see that confidence in God and humility in regards to oneself,
yes,
and one's weaknesses very much fit together.
Sure.
They're complements to each other.
Yes.
Yeah, so that's good. So this is one very important element,
yes,
to have a prayer life that you persevere in, then to have this acceptance of yourself,
yes,
to have confidence,
yes,
in God and humility,
yes,
about the self you accept.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
What other elements would you see?
I think one other very important element is to live the present moment, to put my past in the mercy of God, forgiveness of God, to put my future in the hands of providence of God, and to live what I have to live today in a simple, peaceful way, and doing my best, but not worrying about the past, neither about the future, and this is very important.
Again, now you're talking Matthew chapter 6,
yes,
about the lilies of the field and the,
yes,
birds of the air.
Yes,
just,
yes,
trust now.
Yes, yes.
Tomorrow's enough problems.
Yes.
Yeah. So, and where do you find though that people run into difficulties with that ability to be in the present? What blocks them from accepting that?
The problem is that towards the past, very often we have regrets, we feel guilty, because we don't understand enough the forgiveness of God, and we are not enough faithful to be sure that God is able to use everything in my life, even my failures, even my sins, for my good. If today I decide to give my life to Jesus, I decide to believe, I decide to hope, I decide to love today, all my past, God can take it and make it something positive for me. And so this faith we need. We have to sometimes to think about the past, to put in the hand of God some sin we never confessed, for instance, or some wound we have and we never entrusted it to God. We have to do this, but to be in peace with the past and to be to live in the present moment. And for the future, I think the most important problem is our fear. We are worried about the future. What will happen? What will be my situation in 1 year or 10 years? How will the world evolve? Which will be the situation of the world in 5 years or 10 years? We very often we worry about that. Now, it's normal to think, to to have questions and to try to build today a positive future for the humanity and for my personal family, for my personal life, but without being worried and in peace, in confidence. Like, it's not easy because very quickly we are afraid and we think a lot, and our imagination shows us all the bad things that could happen. And So we have to live the present time, to trust in God, and to do what we can do, and to prepare what we have to prepare for the future. We have to think about it sometimes, but in a peaceful and confident way.
Yeah, so there's only so much you can know about what's going to happen tomorrow.
No, we don't know.
Yet alone down the road. And I've been impressed, especially by one priest I met, but by other priests I read about, who didn't expect to be put into prison.
Yes.
By, one priest I know was in Chinese prison camp. Others were in Russian camps. And they could only deal with, they didn't know what was going to happen. They could be shot any day, but they prayed that day. Mm-hmm. They did whatever they could to celebrate Mass that day.
Yes, yes.
And help the prisoners, that day. That's oftentimes where we have to be. Mm. So, these are some very important elements of spiritual life. In we just have a couple more minutes before we go to questions. But, given that, what approach to prayer, like besides being persevering, what should somebody do when they sit down to pray? What should they seek to do at that moment?
Mm. I think the most important thing at the beginning is to put himself in the presence of God. God is present in front of me. He's present also in my heart. I think for prayer life, it's important to understand the presence of God in us. So to be in the presence of God and in an act of faith, of confidence, and in the desire to love God. At the beginning is very important, how we put ourselves in the presence of God, like children in front of the Father, or friend with his friend. We can use different images. You find the scripture, but to be at the presence of God. And after, we can do different things according to. I think the basis of our prayer life should be the meditation of the Word of God. So take some text of the Scriptures, for instance, the readings of the Mass today, and to meditate, not with too much with intellectual meditation, but to receive and to repeat inside these words, and asking God to understand what He wants to tell us through the Word. And transform this meditation, this welcoming of the Word, in prayer, asking God to live what the Scripture is telling, or thanking God for beautiful things He's telling us through this passage of Scripture, and so on. And at the end, to thank God for this time in His presence, and to ask God to live according to what we did understand in the what we have been meditating during this time. So we can take 15 minutes, half an hour, like that. It can be a very good way of prayer. Now, sometimes it works very well. Sometimes we feel poor, we do not understand, but it's not important. If we are faithful, even if we have sometimes not a very beautiful moment, we have to be faithful. And if we search God, we will find God.
Prayer is not a task where we accomplish something, but it's a relationship.
It's a meeting with God.
Yeah,
and that's being at the presence of God and receiving God. There are different ways to pray. We can meditate the Scriptures, as I told. We can also say a rosary. We can stay in silence. So it's a beautiful, most beautiful prayer, in a simple act of faith, of confidence, of love, but in silence. If we can, it's very good. But and we can also use different, read a psalm I love, a beautiful prayer I could find in a book. So we are very free in prayer life. Right. And each one has to find the way he has to pray.
Exactly.
But we have to be faithful and to take every day a time of prayer and sometimes a longer time for adoration, for instance, 1 hour of adoration of the Blessed Sacrament, if
yes.
it is possible, it's very,
yes.
very good and very important.
Absolutely.
But the Spirit, the Holy Spirit will guide us. And one thing I think also is very important in prayer life is when we take time for prayer day after day, well, sometimes it's very beautiful because we feel peace, we feel happiness, we feel the presence of God, the consolation of the Holy Spirit. Well, sometimes it's very beautiful, but sometimes it's not so easy. Because in this time of prayer, of silence, of solitude, sometimes all our problems come out. My hunger, my difficulty to be concerned, to recollect myself in prayer, my...
all the other difficulties,
all the difficulties
that come up in life.
So, but it's positive.
Right,
it's
yeah.
positive. We have to accept this, accept to be poor, and all this to put in the hands of God.
Yeah.
And I in the life of the King Saint Louis from France, somebody tells that once Jesus spoke to him and he told him, "You want to pray like a saint? I invite you to pray like a poor." So sometimes we must accept to pray like poor, because according to the Psalms, the prayer that God hears
is the prayer of the,
is
poor.
A prayer of the poor.
Right.
So the when experience of prayer is very strange because sometimes it's very beautiful, a very great happiness, sometimes a very deep sense of poverty. But
right.
it is positive. We have to accept it and to hope in God and to put all our confidence in God and not in ourselves. Prayer is a school of humility.
One part of our poverty is that we've just run out of some time for this part of the show. So we're going to take a break.
Okay.
We're going to come back because we want your questions and your comments to help us continue this discussion. So please stay with us. Welcome back. You know, before we go on, I'd like to share some sad news with you all. Very popular and great friend of Mother Angelica, of the network, of myself, Penny Lord, passed away last night, about 8:23. She was born 1928, and she just died last night. So we first all love, you know, want to express our condolences to her husband Bob. They were a great team together in loving each other and serving our Lord. And we want to also pray for her and ask you to pray for repose of her soul and for all the people, plus to pray in gratitude for the great work she did in making so many videos and series and writing books and pilgrimages, retreats, all the great work the Lord used her to do. So God bless you and God rest you, Penny. Also, want to mention something that we'd love to invite you to do if you can. We enjoy having you come and be part of our network. If you can make a pilgrimage here, we certainly want to invite you to be here, but we ask that you contact our pilgrimage department at 205-271-2966 or go to the website ewtn.com and they'll give you information about the times of masses, programs, tours, directions to get up to Hantsville, and places to stay and places to eat. Now, the French are very famous for absolutely wonderful cuisine.
Yes.
However, I hope before you leave Alabama, you get some fried green tomatoes. Some good food here too. So I would love to have you come and join us as well. All right. You ready for some questions?
Yes.
All right, let's start. We're going to start off with a phone call first. Hello, Clara. Clara, are you there?
Yes.
Hi, where are you from?
Florida.
Great. And what's your question? You have a question, Clara?
Yes. I keep praying that I could walk better and drive my car to go to church to serve my Lord, but it's not getting answered. What am I doing?
All right. So we'll translate that question to Father.
Ça ne rien vient de cela à l'église et rien se passe.
So Clara, you know, is asking God for something good, namely physical strength, so she can go to church, but she's not getting an answer to that. What do you say?
Oui, je n'ai pas compris. Donc c'est là. Elle va. So she goes. She can't walk to church.
Yeah, she can't drive.
To
she c'est can't ça. Walk. Donc, elle, and she's asking God for help, and she's not getting an answer to that prayer.
Oui. Elle voudrait bien aller à l'église, mais elle ne peut pas marcher, elle ne peut pas avec sa voiture. Qu'est-ce qu'elle fait?
It's not possible to have contact with the parish and try to find a solution.
That I don't know, but she's more concerned. She prays for this.
Mais le bon Dieu ne répond pas. C'est le problème. Le bon Dieu ne répond pas.
We don't have to be discouraged because sometimes I think God listens all our prayers. But sometimes he does not give an answer immediately, or how we think he should answer.
Yeah.
But I think we don't have to be discouraged. We have to ask and to persevere, to be in hope, and let Lord do what he wants to do. But perhaps I think also sometimes it's important to speak with somebody when we have a special difficulty, because this kind of question, I think. We have also to know what is the context of this person to give a good answer.
Right.
So perhaps she has to speak with somebody. But I think what is most important is to trust in God. And even if he does not answer quickly, the fact that we ask makes us in relationship with him. And something is happening. God is working inside us. So it's not the prayer is not lost. It's not a lost time.
Right. But here's another thing I wonder. You know, sometimes we're like for in this case, Clara is asking that she be able to go to church. She wants to worship.
Yes.
She wants to be at Mass. This is what's in her heart. But sometimes I know myself that I have a good thing I want, but sometimes I pray for a specific solution.
Yes.
That the Lord might have another way
Yes, yes.
For me to have that prayer answered. Yes. That is not just, it's not just that I have my good ideas, but also his are very yes. good. Yes. And it may be that she will be able to help somebody else if our Lord answers it differently
yes, yes.
than she expects.
And also I think she has to be confident that even if she wants to go to Mass, and even if she can't go, I am sure she receives the same blessing, the same love from God as she was able to go to Mass, because
right.
God is everywhere.
Right.
And God usually uses Mass and is very beautiful. Mm. But when we can't go to Mass, Lord is able to give us the same graces, the same blessing that in Mass when we are at home. If
right.
it's
sure, I would suggest that she pray, Lord, get me to church to be with you. And if you have some other way besides me driving, then you figure that out.
Yes.
I'm going to trust you. And in my, like you were saying,
yes.
in our poverty, we let him come up with riches
yes.
he has in mind instead of the ones I want. Mm-hmm. Let's go to a question from our studio audience. Ma'am, where are you from?
Belmont, New York.
Belmont, New York. Now, are you welcome back there?
Well,
I understand the governor doesn't welcome pro-life people and pro-Second Amendment people. Are you going to be able to go back home?
I guess I'm going to have to sneak in to get my things and leave.
Well, if that's you come on down. Our Governor Bentley here in Alabama said, y'all can just come on down here. You're welcome. We don't worry about those
Well,
things.
Thank you. The weather is much better, too.
So what's your question?
Well, if I'm understanding correctly, what we have to do, or what we should do, is accept where we are as God's grace gift, leave our baggage behind us. But how do we know that we are talking with, how do we recognize the voice of God, I guess?
Right, so how, yeah.
Sometimes God speaks to us and we recognize because our heart understand that God is speaking. But in other moment, we don't hear God speaking in a clear way. But we have to go on to do what seems to be good, the good choice according to my vocation, according to the gospel, and not worry if I do not always understand in a very clear way the voice of the Lord. Sometimes God speaks, sometimes he does not speak, because he wants we to go on with faith and to do what is normal to do in our vocation. He has not a special things to tell us at that time. So,
in fact, but most normally, the way God speaks is going to be in the words of Scripture.
Yes, yes, yes.
That's the norm.
Yes.
We don't need usually other messages as much as we need to yes. enter into the words of Scripture.
Mm. Alors, when we have some decision difficult to take, well, I think we don't understand the will of God. But sometimes it happens. It's not easy because it can be suffering. So we don't have to discourage. We have to pray. You have to sometimes to wait that God shows us which is the good choice. We have to ask somebody, a priest or a spiritual guide, explain the situation and try to understand the will of God. But sometimes it takes time. What is important is to remain in trust, to do today what seems to be good, according to the light I have, according to the word of God. Never discourage and to go on and to say, God, you know I want to do your will, I want to listen to you, but I do this. If it is not good, speak to me and help me to understand better what you are waiting for me. But in a peaceful and confident way, not in terror, but like a children who...
Not with anxiety?
Oui.
Yeah, no, no, you don't need to be anxious.
Like a child speaking with a father. And but I think if we want to do the will of God, God will show us in important decision what we have to do. because the gospel says search and you will find. Alors, sometimes it takes time. And when we do not have a special light, we have to do what seems good according to, as I told, our vocation, the light of the Word of God, and what the Church is teaching us. And also, sometimes we do not receive an answer because sometimes we want to know things for the future. And to know the will of God in 1 year, I cannot. I can only understand the will of God today, what He wants. And if my question is, what God is asking me today, it's very much more easy to have an answer if I live the present moment. Because sometimes we have so many questions, but sometimes it is curiosity or crainte.
Fear.
If we live the present moment, it's more easy to understand the will of God and what we have to do today.
All right, we have another question called in. Hello, Karen?
Yes.
Hi, where are you from?
I am from Syracuse, New York.
Syracuse, all right. And what is your question?
My question is, how do you begin to start a spiritual prayer life? And also, to let you know that we already had a march downtown in Syracuse for pro-life.
Good.
We had that January the 18th. We're going to lobby March. We're going to lobby in Albany April the 18th.
Well, you tell your governor that he is welcome to be with you and that you want to invite him into that because he may not feel well, but we want him to be welcome at the pro-life march and just join right in with us. Mm-hmm. Now, how do you begin the spiritual life is her question.
I think in a simple way. So today I decide to give my life to God. I decide to believe in Him. I decide to trust in Him and to do what He wants from me according to what I understand. But I think the most important thing is to the confidence in God, because the first thing God is asking from us is not to be perfect, not to be arrived at the top level, but it's to have confidence in Him and to have the desire to follow Him and to do His will. And this is the way we have to begin. Today I begin to give my life to God, to ask Him to guide me, and I believe in Him, and I open my life to His presence, and I take time for prayer. Every day I decide to take 15 minutes, half an hour, according to my possibility, to pray the Lord, to meditate the Scripture, and we go on. Yeah. And, I think another thing, in my opinion, is important also, is to accept the events of the life that we meet. Because in our life, sometimes we meet very beautiful situations, that make us very happy and satisfied. Sometimes we meet difficulties and hardship and so on. I think what is very important also, this is the trust we have to express towards God, to accept our situation and to live the life with the life that God gives us. Accept myself, accept the situation in which I am, the people I am living with, and go on, and day after day. And I think if I have this inner disposition of confidence and desire to love God and faithfulness to prayer and to do what I can do today, the Lord will guide me and work in me, and He will speak to my heart and show me what I have to do. What is very important also is not to be alone. We have to belong to a community, because nobody can be a Christian alone. I have to belong to a parish, to a prayer group, to different kind of things that exist in the church, but not to be alone. I have to share my faith, to have brothers and sisters to pray with, and this is very important too, because live the gospel is living in the family of the church.
I think too, something you mentioned, to start off with 15 minutes a day at least or something, and to realize you don't have to start off with 3 hours of contemplation your first time. You grow in it.
Yes, yes.
You know, I began eating milk.
Yes.
And later on, cereal and more solid food.
I think
we just grow gradually in how much we can pray. And that's another good thing to be comfortable with. Start off small and let the hunger grow.
Yes.
Another question from our studio audience. Sir, where are you from?
I am from Eagle Pass, Texas.
Great little town. Good to have you over here.
Thank you.
And your question?
Yes. So, in addition to the question just asked, I'm curious, how does one prepare to mentally, when they get out of work after the busy day, to prepare and mentally read the scripture and be able to, kind of like, what prayers does one say to empty oneself, empty one's mind, to live in that present moment?
I should say there are two preparations. One during all the day, because during the whole day, if I try to do the will of God, if I think often to God, if I offer Him what I am living during the whole day, it will be more easy to pray in the evening. But if during all the day I don't think at all to God, I never speak to Him, it will be much more difficult to begin prayer when you have the time of prayer after the... And when you have the time of prayer, you have to put yourself in the presence of God, an act of faith, a simple act of faith. And you can use some prayers who help you. Invoke the Holy Spirit, invoke Virgin Mary, read a psalm you like, a prayer at the beginning. But the more important is an act of faith. God, I am here with you, for you. You are my father. I know you are present. You love me. And I am happy to spend 50 minutes with you. And just ask you to visit me, to bless me during this time of prayer. And so this can be the beginning. There are many different ways you can do that, but be at the presence of God. And after... If during your time of prayer you want to meditate a text of the scripture, you read it in a very simple way, asking God to understand, and you let the word of God descend in your heart and make a prayer out of the reading you are doing. For instance, if you are touched, if you are reading a gospel who speaks about the mercy of God, the forgiveness, but you can thank God for His goodness. If you are reading a text who invites you to charity, towards, you ask God the grace to be able to practice what you have been reading. So read out of this reading a dialogue with the Lord. But I think it's not a technique, it's a conversation. And I think the more and more we pray, the Holy Spirit guides us and put in our hearts the attitudes and the understanding how it is good to be with the Lord and to speak with Him. So we have to be confident in the pedagogy of the Lord. He's guiding us. What is important is to begin and to be perseverant. And after, it's as many things in the life, we have to learn it. But we learn making it, so doing it.
All right, let's try. We have just about a minute or so left, but I'd like to talk to Jane. Hello, Jane.
Yes, hello.
Hi, and what is your question?
Well, I have returned to the church after 40 years.
Welcome back.
Thank you. It's wonderful. And I'm a beginner trying to pray, and I am so distracted. Noises and smells, and I think, oh, what am I going to cook for dinner? And it's so hard to get back into the discipline of prayer.
All right, we'll have to answer real quickly, Father, about 30 seconds. But what do you do about distractions?
Je crois que c'est normal d'avoir des distractions.
It's normal to have distractions.
Yes, okay.
So we don't have to discourage.
Right.
But when we realize we are distracted, we try to return at the presence of the Lord. But we don't have to discourage. We must try to be in contact with the Lord, with faith, with the scripture we meditate or the rosary we are praying, but our mind always is a little distracted.
Right.
But the more and more we love, the more and more we are united to God. What is important is not to pray only with the head, but to love more and more. And so the problem of distraction is less important because even if the mind is a little distracted, the heart is loving.
Exactly. Well, one of the things that I'm distracted by is that we're run out of time. So join me, if you would, in giving a blessing. May Almighty God bless you and keep you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And we can bring Father and all the other guests and special programming we do for March of Life because it's your network. Please keep us in between your gas bill, electric bill, and cable bill. And we'll pay our bills too. Thank you.